So in this video, I'm going to talk about the differentiation of signal with a lock-in amplifier. So in the condensed matter experimentalist lab, you normally see people do differential conductance measurement, especially as a in cryogenics lab or device labs. So why we need it actually, the differential conductance measurement? So if you see, I'm giving a classical example. So you take a big resistor and you measure V versus I, you will get a straight line. But you take a smaller device like quantum point contact or quantum dot, you started weird phenomena. So the IV will not be linear. So now instead of seeing this, and these slopes I have drawn it, very big, it can be very, very small. So if it is very, very small, these steps, it is very hard to depict in this. So what you need to find out the slope at each and every point, which will give you the better idea. So for example, here it is, slope is changing a little bit. To naked eye, it might not seem it is it is doing anything. When you take a differentiation, it's a voila, you'll see, okay, there is something happening. So I already told you about lock-in amplifier. Lock-in amplifier is the marvelous piece of instrument. It does everything for us. So this is another thing which it can do for us. Now for the differential resistance or differential conductance, what one does is normally they superimpose a smaller AC signal, because lock-in amplifier, it locks at particular frequency. It detects, you superimpose a smaller signal, AC signal, at some frequency wherever you want to detect the signal. To your major signal. For example, in this case, we are measuring V versus I and IDC probably. You take a bigger I, so your big I is there, whatever is signal, IDC, whatever, and you superimpose a small AC signal, IEJ omega naught T, which is varying at frequency omega naught. I is a smaller amplitude, very, very small amplitude of the signal. Now I can write, earlier V was, this V was a function of I, now V is a function of I plus I, small I, e j omega naught t. Now if this I is very, very small compared to I can Taylor expand it, okay? That's very easy. So if you, everyone knows the Taylor expansion, you get V s I curly V by it into I e j omega naught t, double derivative I square j omega naught and 2 j omega naught t. So if you look very carefully, what we are doing here is, if you see the first derivative Vs. So if you want to you see the first derivative, you need to measure at first omega. Very easy, right? First, if you measure in lock-in amplifier, you'll get the first derivative at omega naught. Now you're measuring the second derivative, you need to measure at 2 omega. So if you want to measure the third derivative, you need to measure at 3 omega, and so on. If you want to measure another derivative, you have to measure at n omega. Of course, you are modulating the signal frequency omega naught, but you have to measure at 1 omega for first derivative, 2 omega at second derivative, 3 omega for third derivative. Now there is a catch. If you see, the signal becomes smaller as we move on from first derivative to second derivative to third derivative and so on, because it's I. So I is already a small number, I square will become smaller number, so the signal will become weaker and weaker. So it becomes very hard to detect, but it makes our life easy in a way that you can do anything at a time. So that's a good point about it. Thanks a lot.